evening, everyone. I'm really glad to be here, and I must say a special word of thanks to Mr. Amit Prabhu for the persistent pursuit in getting me here. Though I came late, I'm so glad that you gave me an opportunity to talk to this amazing group of people this evening. And thank you, Mr. Kripa, for that amazing introduction. I don't know if I can rise up to that, but I'll try. About this conference, that the focus has been on storytelling. And I was really surprised because the way we fought misinformation, disinformation, and fake news for those 4 months was using the medium of storytelling. I was posted in a place called Jogalamba Gadwal as the district police chief, and I was also holding additional charge of Vanaparthi district. We had almost 400 villages and a couple of tribal hamlets. In almost every village, this issue was going on. So in the first phase, when the issue was brought to my notice, the way we fought it was through door-to-door campaign. We came up with an intensive educative session, and my police officers were going to each house in the villages, and they were educating people about it. And it, after a while, we realized that it was not proving to be quite effective. So I had to resort to some conventional methods like using folk singers, taking the help of drummers, locally they are called as the Dappu artist, town criers. So when Mr. Prabhu told me that the theme of the event is storytelling, I was really happy that I can explain the series of events as a story. Quite recently, I wrote an article on the issue of fake news and disinformation, which is spread through social media, and how it is instigating people to kill each other. How WhatsApp was used as a medium to instigate lynching in various parts of the country. So in one of the latest articles, I shared an experience about an incident that happened 4 months back. Since the time is very short, I thought I'll rather read that passage out instead of elaborating in detail. Bear with me, it's going to take exactly 2.5 minutes. So it goes like this. I was just 8 weeks into my new posting as the district police chief of Jogalamba Gadwal district in Telangana that an incident happened, which made us look at social media as not just a medium of communication, but as a deadly weapon in the hands of anti-social elements. Balanagamma Ogukatha is one of the most popular Bura Kathas. Bura means tambura. Tambura is a musical instrument. And Katha is story. In Nadigada region, this place is called Nadigada because Nadi means river, Gada means a piece of land. Gadwal is located between two major rivers, River Krishna and River Tungabhadra. So it's one of the most favorite pastime. And it is part of an oral storytelling technique in the Katha tradition performed across the villages of Telangana and Andhra Pradesh. One can see this form of narrative entertainment during the summer jatras. So I'm talking about a phase which happened between March and July this year. It became the most significant medium of awakening during the Indian independence movement in the southern states, inviting the wrath of the British government and also the Nizam's regime in Telugu-speaking states. Both of them banned it in their dominions. The topic usually is a Hindu mythological story or a contemporary social issue. And even today, you can see this form of storytelling being practiced in some of the rural parts of the state. So the story starts now. Manema and Maheshwaramma are Budagajanga folk singers. Budagajanga is a community, a local community, who carry forward this tradition in a limited form. In their early 50s, these two women traveled far and wide to perform Burakatha on the famous tale of Balanagamma, who used to be a local a deity. She's worshipped, she's spoken about, there are so many tales on her life. So they go to weekly markets, local fairs and festivals. Sometimes they seek alms. Sometimes they perform and the local organizers pay them some money. Their forefathers used to be Janga Mistrals, soothsayers and religious mendicants. So on this day, I'm talking about 11th May 2018, this wasn't different for them, for these two women, until that fateful moment struck when they missed the last bus that would have taken them back to their village after the performance in the local festival. So they decided to rest for a while under the banyan tree on a small platform next to it. As night fell, they took shelter in the temple of the local deity in the village where they were performing. At the stroke of midnight, a villager saw them resting inside the temple. He rushed back to the village and woke everyone up, the entire village, and told them that he saw two women who looked exactly like the child lifters he saw in a WhatsApp video. And within about 10 minutes, the whole village gathered, and these two women were forcibly taken out of the temple, and they were locked up in the Gram Panchayat office. Gram Panchayat is the local village council office. So the villagers firmly believed that these women were child kidnappers, because that's what all the WhatsApp groups spoke about 2 weeks, asking them to be careful, to protect their children, and to attack anyone who they thought had a suspicious demeanor about them. When all the villagers reached the temple, these women were dragged out. One of them was tied to a tree nearby, and the other lady was dragged, and she was brought to the mob. And people started questioning. Just because they were women, they were not manhandled in the first few minutes. But some of them started attacking them, and these women kept pleading that they be spared as they are from the neighboring district. But the villagers didn't want to listen because one of the latest videos that they saw in WhatsApp had visuals of two women who looked exactly like these two women. One of the concerned villager had the sense of, he had the sense to call the local police, and my sub-inspector and team reached the village in the next 10 minutes. And they were a team of four, and they were facing a mob of 400. And they refused to hand over the women to the police team. It took some time for the sub-inspector, who reached there, and he started asking them who has done this. There was no reply. And then a voice came from the middle of the mob, and they said they came to take care of our children. And the whole village stood in affirmation, and they were pretty sure that they were kidnappers, and they refused to hand them over to the police officers. It took almost 2.5 hours for the police team to collect their identity from the neighboring village. We requested the sub-inspector of the village from where these women came from, and their Aadhaar copy was collected over WhatsApp that was shown to each villager that night. So by the time the entire village got convinced, it was 2:30 a.m. and with great difficulty, these women were rescued. We safely escorted them out, and they were taken to the village, and they were handed over to the relatives. So this was the first incident that we came across, and I'm talking about a series of incidents. This was the first major incident which had the potential to turn into lynching. So now I'll take you back to 27th March. This was exactly after a week I took over as the district police chief of Joglamba Gadwal. So wherever I worked, I mostly worked in rural districts of Telangana. I used to implement a system called the village police officers. So typically, if you have been exposed to how a police station in a rural part of the country works, I'm sure you know that each police station has a team of officers. A police station is usually headed by a sub-inspector of the rank of SHO, station house officer of the rank of sub-inspector. And he will have a team of 30 to 45 police constables and head constables. And they have a jurisdiction over 40 to 50 villages. So what I did in the past is to make sure that each constable is allotted to at least 2 to 3 villages so that he has an opportunity to visit the villages to build up community partnership. Because traditionally in India, we have inherited our policing system from the British. Nothing much has been done in terms of reforming the police force. So we have a system wherein you take the case of a village. For the last 10 years, if no crime was reported in that village, there is no reason for the local police officers to visit there. So there's absolute disconnect between the community and the police officers, and this is one of the foremost reasons why we have this huge mistrust between the community and the police department. So I use village police officer system, wherein each police officer is expected to visit the village at least thrice or four times in a week whenever he has time, and this is apart from the core mandate of his work. He goes to the village, spends time with them, exchange phone numbers, he has to understand the felt needs of the community. He comes back and shares that piece of information with the station house officer, who has to improve his policing activities in that particular area, depending on the needs of the community. So this has really worked very well for me in terms of carrying forward my community outreach activities in creating awareness against the social issues. So after taking over, the first thing I did was to implement this system, and I was conducting my very first review meeting with the village police officers. So we were taking stock of the social issues and antisocial activities, criminal activities. So one of the constables, he stood up and he said, "Ma'am, I observed something very unusual in all the villages that I visited as part of my work. I found that in at least 15 villages, people were not sleeping outside their houses." And we are talking about March. March in Telangana is extremely hot, and it is unusual to see people sleeping inside their houses. And Gadwal is slightly, it's a backward region. People have smaller houses, bigger families. So to see that one family which has at least 6 to 7 members sleeping inside that small house is strange. It was weird. So he told me that this is something that we need to investigate, because this, for me, is very weird. So I asked all my village police officers to go back to all their designated villages immediately and do a thorough check and come back to me with a report. So in the next 48 hours, they all came back and they told me that they saw this happening almost every villages. And then we got into action. We told them to find out what was the problem, what was the cause. So they came up with a bunch of videos, images, and voice messages, which were so graphic. So the first bunch of videos that we collected from all these villages, mind you, there's one piece of information that I must tell you before I go ahead with the story, is that Gadwal, like I said in the beginning, is very backward in terms of everything, socially, economically. If you look at the literacy rate, even today it is only 48%, less than 50%. Most of them don't have toilets, but you will see people having a smartphone and access to internet, which was news to me, which was news to my boys, my team. So we were really surprised to learn that most of these people had smartphones, they had access to internet, and they were receiving these videos over WhatsApp and Facebook. I didn't want to believe that in the beginning, because my understanding was, how can a person use WhatsApp and Facebook and start posting stuff, sharing information, if he can't read and write? Digital literacy is zero, literacy is 48%, but this thing was happening. So they all came back with this one particular video which was giving them sleepless nights. In almost all the villages, people refused to step out after 6 o'clock. They didn't let their children go out and play. There was a self-imposed curfew-like situation in all these villages. So this video had visuals of 4 people. One guy is about to die and he's lying down, and 4 guys are standing, 4 guys are standing in a circle, and one man is putting his hand inside his body, which is already cut open, blood is oozing out, blood is everywhere, and he's putting his hand inside his body and he's pulling out his organs one by one. And the man is still alive and he's pleading for his life. So this video was so graphic, it ran for about 2 minutes, and this was going viral. And all these people saw this video, and this video came with another voice message which said that there is a gang out there, the interstate criminal gang called Parthi gang. Parthis are part of this denotified criminal tribes, and some of them joined mainstream, some of them still engage in criminal activities. So this voice message in pure Telugu spoke about Parthi gang out on the prowl, looking out for people. If they come across anybody, they'll just kill them and take away their properties and valuables. So in the first week after we noticed this issue, we examined all those videos. I call my IT core team, my information technology core team, which is a group of trained police officers who are tech savvy, not very high tech, but they have bare minimum experience of dealing with information technology. So we examined each image, each video, and we were pretty sure that they were all morphed. The video that was giving them sleepless nights, for me, it looked like somebody used face mapping. I'm sure if some of you are an expert on AI, I think there are face mapping tools. So I'm sure such videos can be created. And this didn't look real to us, and the people who were in that video didn't look like Indians. And a couple of other videos which had visuals of things happening in Syria, but the way it was spread and it was circulated here, people were made to believe that it is happening right next to their houses, in their villages. There was a state of frenzy, there was a mass hysteria. People started calling me up after 11 o'clock. For about 45 days, I barely slept. Every night after 11, people used to make frantic calls saying that Mauriki donga ucharu, means thieves have come to our village. Somebody is throwing stones on my window pane. My sheep has been taken away by somebody. Somebody has taken the child from the neighboring house. When you go there and when you see that, when you make an inquiry in the village, you find that nothing of that sort happened. But people were living in this state of frenzy. So we decided to take things under our control. I called for an urgent meeting where I trained this group of police officers. First, what we did was to teach them how to differentiate between a real and a fake image. And honestly, it's not very easy, it's tough. But with basic common sense and a little bit of knowledge about how morphing is done, we could teach these police officers how to differentiate between these images. And they were all sent out to all these 400 villages. In the first phase of the campaign that we started, they literally went door to door. So during the day, they used to take care of their policing activities, which is controlling law, taking care of law and order, crime control, crime prevention, prisoner escort. After finishing all this work, in the evening, they used to go to these villages, interact with the people. They went to every house, and they appealed to the people not to believe in these rumors. And they appealed to the people to inform us if they found something like this in WhatsApp or Facebook. We did this for about 15 days. And at that point in time, lynching was not an issue in the country. We didn't have any major lynching incidents. And then as we entered April, towards third and fourth week of April, we started reading about lynching incidents in the newspapers, which were happening elsewhere. And by then, I already had 12 incidents, different incidents. In one case, there was this shepherd boy who was a school dropout, didn't want to go to school, so his father forced him to take care of the sheep. So every morning, he's supposed to take the sheep out for rearing, come back in the evening. He didn't want to do that, but he had a smartphone. So all he did was, through day in and day out, was to look at the videos through Facebook and YouTube. So one day, he was looking at all these rumors which were being circulated in WhatsApp, and he decided to escape from his work. So around 12:30 midnight, he came running back to the village and told the family that a gang of 12 persons came, and he was attacked, and he was bleeding. So the whole village believed that the WhatsApp videos were true and the messages were true, that a gang came, an interstate criminal gang came, and that gang was attacking this boy. So in the meantime, everybody ganged up, and they all formed themselves into vigilante groups. They were wielding lathis, they were carrying sticks, and they started patrolling the villages. We went to the village, we tried to convince them, we told them that, no, there is no such gang. I personally spoke to the boy. It was pretty obvious that he was lying. It was not true. The way he was narrating the incident, with too many missing links. So it took some time for us, almost 18 hours, to get the confidence of the boy, to let him open up, and finally he confessed that he was lying because he didn't want to go for this work. He picked up some wild thorns and he did the self-inflicted injuries. But in those 18 hours, where like, it was really tough for us because the entire village, a village of 1,500 people out there in the open, refused to listen to the police officers, and they were doing vigilante work. And in the process, anybody who walks into the village, if he happens to be a stranger, if she happens to be a stranger, they were restrained. They were questioned. They were locked up in the Gram Panchayat office. 400 villages, almost 15 lakh people, and we were barely a group of 600 police officers. So we couldn't have done this quite effectively in the first phase. And the very first incident of lynching happened, lynching incident was reported in state of Telangana. It happened in a place called Bhimgal in Nizamabad district. So that gave us, that was a red flag for us, because we didn't want any lynching to happen in my district. So in the second phase, what we did, we gathered all these town criers. Locally, they are called as Dappu artists. This is an old custom where if a message had to be conveyed to the local villages, these town crier will be hired, and his responsibility is to go start beating the drum. Yeah, I'm aware of that, thank you. He'll start beating up the drum, he'll gather people, and the message will be conveyed to them. Sometimes it is about marriage or funeral or about a government welfare scheme. So we called all these people and we taught them how to convey this message in 1 minute to appeal to people not to believe in these rumors. And in the third phase, I used my own police cultural troupe. I have a small little team of police officers who can sing and dance. I called them and we wrote a song on fake news by taking into consideration the local socio-economic condition of the region. If you look at the socio-economic condition of this region, which is traditionally called as Palamuru, people always went out in search of jobs. So Palamuru labor is an economic phenomenon. I think Mr. Amartya Sen spoke about it in one of his books. So people always go out of the state in search of work. They find jobs in Pune, Bombay, Bangalore, nearby states. So we wrote a song in a way that tomorrow you might go to Bombay, you might go to Pune. What if the people living there think of you as a child lifter, because you are a stranger there? So if any stranger walks into your village, please don't look at them as a child lifter just because you saw one fake video in WhatsApp. So this song was written, and they practiced this song, and they went around each village. Every day one village was covered, and through songs and ballet and through street plays, this message was conveyed to the people. In 4 months, I had 23 incidents where all these incidents had the potential to turn into lynching. But because we were doing this intensive educative campaign, even though people were restrained, even though strangers were attacked, somebody in the village used to call up the police officers and we could reach there on time and rescue these people from getting lynched. So that's how the campaign worked for us. And the way the folk singers were used, we wrote the songs in the local dialect so that they identify with that. And the programs were conducted in the evening when they came back from their work, from the agricultural fields. So we used to gather them in the local school or at the Gram Panchayat building, and every night a program was conducted. So after 4 months, when almost 27 incidents of lynching were reported in different parts of the country, in my district we had none. We had zero incidents, only because this campaign. Thank you so much. But it wasn't easy for us because, like I said, police department is understaffed. We are overburdened. We have different kinds of work to carry on a day-to-day basis. In spite of that, my team of police officers were really motivated enough to take out that extra time every day, 2 hours, 3 hours. And they traveled. They spent their own money. They spent money from their pockets to go to even the remotest part of the district, to tribal hamlets, to teach people about misinformation and fake news, because we thought it was our responsibility. If you want to look at the incident as a merely platform issue, yes, we can do that, but it is also a social issue. This is an enforcement issue, this is a social issue, this is also a platform issue. When it comes to the challenges that we faced through these 4 months, I had been speaking about this, I've been speaking about this in the last 3-4 months, that the question of traceability is the biggest challenge for us. I did try, I won't say that I didn't try, I really wanted to go after that person who was making these fake videos and, you know, pushing people to kill each other. We tried, but we reached nowhere, because there's no way we could trace the origin of these messages. So I really hope that, you know, representatives of various digital platforms who are here this evening come together, think together, and come up with a solution. Because police department alone cannot deal with this issue. It is a collective social responsibility. So I'd like to urge each one of you to come together and find solutions. And various parts of the country, this issue is not over. Even though lynching is taken care of now in various parts of the country, most of the police officers have been working very proactively, so the issue has been brought under control. Yesterday it was about a criminal gang. Today it is about a childlifting gang. Tomorrow it may be about something else. So how are we going to deal with this? How are we going to stop these people from spreading misinformation, which is making people die? Innocents. If you look at the videos, particularly one video, the incident happened in Bidar, where one software engineer, I think he worked for Accenture, he was lynched to death by a mob of 1,500 people. I was looking at the video, and the video was shot over the shoulder of a man who was holding on to his 3-year-old daughter, and the dad and daughter are watching it. And the lynching is happening there, and he's watching it with his daughter. What are we leaving behind for the future generation? Intolerance? Somebody is getting lynched and we are just standing and watching. Like I said, it's a collective social responsibility. All of us have to think about it and all of us have to put an end to it. So I tried, and using our limited resources and manpower, we managed to contain it in a region which was extremely sensitive politically and socially. So once again, thank you so much, Praxis, for bringing me over to this platform so that I could make this appeal to each one of you to offer solutions to us. We are ready to work. We are ready to be proactive. We are ready to reach out to the community, educate them, and save them, rescue them. But we can't do it alone. We need the support of each one of you, and I hope that very soon we shall have that solution. Thank you so much.